in this, we will do lab 5, which is build your DB server and interact with your DB using an application. So the first thing I'm going to do is to start the lab. I think I have started the lab just recently. My lab is still ready. And now let us go to the scenario and understand what we are going to have for today. So basically, what we have a web server, which is basically, this is what we create in the last lab. This is what we create in lab number 3. And now we want to add a new component to this architecture where we add basically an RDS, and that RDS, we will test that our web server interact with it. So the first thing we need to do after starting the lab and accessing the AWS console, you can see the AWS console is here. Let me move this to a second screen. And this is will enable me to basically have more freedom in the creation process. So now in the first task, guys, we want to create at first a security group. So we want to go to the EC2. Or even you can go and find security group in the VPC. So go to the VPC, and from your VPC, you have security group. Now in the instruction in step number 7, we want to create a security group. And the name of the security group will be a DB security group. And the description is going to be to permit access from web security group. And this is, you need to be careful here because you need to disable the default VPC and you select the lab VPC alone. Then you need to add a rule, and this is will be basically MySQL Aurora. You can search for it, MySQL Aurora, which open port 3306. And in the custom part, we want to basically, in the custom part, we want just to enable a specific security group called the web security group. So from custom, click here in the box, you can find that there is a web security group there. Now, why we need this security group, or why we want to enable just only this security group? If you open your EC2s and you see that you have a web server here, that web server use that security group. So we are saying here, we only allow the traffic to come from this web server to go to the RDS. So we only want to allow that web server to access our RDS. So we created the security group. Now let us move to task number 2. So we need to go to the RDS console. From the RDS console, we want to create a subnet group. Now the subnet group is basically just only a way to control where this RDS will be placed. So basically we want to make sure that our RDS based on the lab instruction, and if you just review the lab instruction, guys, at the diagram, you will see that they want us to launch the RDS in the private subnet 1 and the private subnet 2. So we want to follow these. In order to achieve that, we need to create an RDS first. So let me go to the RDS console, go to the subnet group, create a DB subnet group. Now this is, should have the name, which is, if you go back to the instruction, the RDS should have the name DB subnet group. And the description will be a DB subnet group again. We need to launch this in lab VPC. Now in the lab VPC, they are saying in the lab instruction, guys, we need to select basically two availability zones, which is US East 1A and 1B. And this is due to the fact that our RDS will be only launched in those two private subnet in US East 1 and US East 1A and 1B. Now, the next thing they are saying in step number 16, we have to select the subnet, which are 10.0.1.0 and 10.0.3.0. Now let me show you why first, so you can understand in the future why you are doing this step in particular. If you go to your VPC and to your subnet, in the lab VPC, you have four subnets. You have private subnet 1 and the private subnet 2. Now look to the IP address for private subnet 2. It's 10.0.3 and subnet 1 is 10.0.1, which means I want only my database to be in a private subnet 1 and the private subnet 2. So let me go back, select 10.0.1.0 and 10.0.3.0. And then I click on create. In task 3 now, we need to go back to our database solution and we create a database. Now we need to select MySQL. That's strange. They have removed MySQL from the page. Now it's okay. MySQL. And now from MySQL, we want to make sure that this is basically a dev test. Now in our setting, we want to keep it as a single AZ deployment. Now the database identifier will be LabDB. LabDB. And the master username is going to be main. The password is going to be lab-password and then lab-password again. Now these are the default for easy create. Now if you switch between easy create and standard create, the standard create are going to give you too many options. Let me close these. Now dev test, single DB, lab DB, main, lab password. Now for the instance machine, they want to use the bare stable class, including T classes. Now the lab is asking you to use T3 micro. So you can see here, I have selected or given T3 micro by default. We need to, in the storage configuration, we need to disable a few checkbox, which is, for example, enable storage auto scaling. And in the connectivity now part, we want to select our lab VPC, and this is will select by the default DB subnet group. Now for our VPC security, most students, they do this mistake. They keep the security group of the default there, and then they choose the DB security group, which is the one I create in this task number one. So we select the DB security group, deselect the default, and then we need to, in additional configuration, give our database a name. We will call it lab because we need that name for later on. So we disable enhanced monitoring and automated backups and encryption. And that's all for this database configuration. So again, guys, it's going to be standard create MySQL. Dev test, it's going to be lab-db, main, lab password, instance T3 micro, 20 for the storage general purpose, in lab VPC, in the DB subnet group, choose existing security group, the DB security group, and deselect the default, and then give the database a name because you will use this in the connection as we will see later on, and then click on the create, the create database. Normally, guys, this will take a few minutes for the DB to be ready. So we want to wait now from a creation to make our DB available. Now, once this finished, I need to go to my EC2. And my EC2 has an application in that web server. That application, we are going to use it. So I'm going to copy the public IP. I'm going to use that application to connect to my RDS just to test. So you can see there is an RDS tab. Here we are going to put the endpoint, the database name, the username, and the password. And this is what we are going to do in the step number 4. Let me go to my RDS. Now, normally this step take up to 4 minutes, guys, so we need to wait for that to finish. Okay, as you can see now, my database is available. So I could see that the status has been changed from creation to available. Now click on LabDB. It will give you a quick information about the connectivity and the security, the port we open, in which VPC we have created this RDS, in which subnet, and which subnet as well, which security group. Also, if you go to the configuration, you could get, for example, the database instance and the DB name. Now, if you go back to your website, we need to now to provide this information, the endpoint, the database, the username, and the password. So let me go back to connectivity, and I will copy the endpoint, and I will paste it here. Now, the database name, if you notice, the database name is called lab. So I'm going back and fill lab here. The username is main and the password was lab-password. Now click submit. You should be able to check that you have a correct connection between the website and your database. So you could interact with your database. You can remove a record, you can add a new record, like test, for example, one@me.com and submit. Just to make sure you have basically a correct configuration between your web server and the RDS. So that will be all for lab 5. Thank you for seeing this and this video, and see you in the next one.